Hello, Shirley Adams with the Sewing Connection, Series 9, Program 7. Are you ever puzzled as you look in the back corners of your closet why in the world you've kept some of the things you find there? If it's absolutely useless and you never want to see it again, get rid of it. But if you can see any promise at all, think of ways you can recycle it into useful items. Turn yesterday into today. As I looked in the back of my closet, I found this shirt. And all kinds of things you can do with an old man's shirt. Even a young man's shirt will do. The point is, a discarded shirt. Well, since I was puzzled about what I was going to do with it, I thought, aha, anything can trigger an idea. So the word puzzle, make a puzzle out of it. What I did was start out with some fusible release sheet. And there are two different varieties on the market, a whole lot of different brands, but two varieties. One of them is a lighter weight one. You fuse something and then you can stitch through it and keep it there permanently by the stitching. The other one you don't sew through at all. It's heavy duty. It's meant only to be fused, and thereafter it's not going to come off. So whether you wash it, dry clean it, whatever, it's going to stay. Read the bolt end and see what is permanent, what is see-through or stitch-through, what is going to be washable or dry cleanable. Know what you're using there and label it when you buy some and take it home so that you don't forget what it's all about. Well, what I use then on this, because I certainly didn't want to stitch around all those odd-shaped puzzle pieces. That would be a bit much. So what I used, of course, is some of the very heavy-duty, the type that's going to be there permanently. So you start out by just fusing it to whatever fabric you're using. Now, a couple of good choices, because you don't want it to ever fray, and even though it fuses permanently, if it's woven fabric, it could fray and make somewhat of a mess. So what I would choose is one of two things, a knit, which is not going to fray, and that'll work out just fine to put that for the puzzle pieces, or what I have done is use one of the synthetic suedes and just cut a lot of pieces out of that, and that doesn't have any edges then to worry about fraying. So once you have this all fused, or before or after, it doesn't matter, go ahead and draw those puzzle pieces whenever you want to. But here's just an easy way to draw puzzle pieces. First of all, just make squares, and then as you're cutting it out, add blips to it. So I did it something like this, just produce some pieces like this and some over this way. And then as I was cutting it out, I added the extra. And not only did I add the blips to it, but on one of those pieces, I cut those blips out a little smaller. So I did it something like this. And this one, I'd probably cut it out the other direction, just so that I'd have a little variety going back and forth. But when I would completely cut out a piece, and I'll just cut out this corner piece, and oh, I guess we'll have this one going this way. But before I actually laid it out on my fabric and fused it down, I would cut one or the other. It doesn't matter which one. Either cut that one smaller or else cut this one a little bit larger, just because I wanted a little daylight between all of them so you could easily see them so that they would show up. And okay, that way I'll just quickly cut off the edge pieces here. That way, once I fuse this one down in place, and then later when I put the next one next to it, boy, this works so well there. I couldn't even, for a minute, get the paper off. But this is the point of all these fusible release sheets on the market. The fact that it does have all the fusible material there, which is now permanently on the fabric, and the paper I've peeled away, and it can just be a throwaway. Or if it's something significant that you're doing, then use that peeled off paper as a pattern so that you can make a duplicate later. But then this, you just put down, you'd line up all the pieces the way you want them to be. The next piece, as I said, is I would cut that one off. Because I've cut this one smaller, I could see a little daylight between them. So you can see as I put it here, this one is smaller than the bigger one that I cut. Therefore, as I leave a little space in between them, the white would show through and they just show up better, which is what you want them to do. Then depending on what fabric you do, I'm just using t-shirt fabric here, so I'll simply put the iron right directly on it. If I'd be using the suede, I'd put a press cloth there between them so that the iron doesn't destroy the suede. And once you have it pressed, it's there to stay. It's not going to come off. So make sure about this before you do any fusing, that you don't want to change your mind. It's not a reversible operation here. Okay, then something else I'm wearing is this jean skirt, this denim skirt. This used to be pants, and you can see why it no longer is. Now, kids would have loved it, but for me it looked a little raggedy and I didn't want to wear it with the raggedy bottoms. So I decided, why don't we cut it off and make a skirt out of it instead? It's a very, very simple process to do. Let me show you. This is all I have left of the original jeans. I have these two legs that are cut off, and I also have the crotch area, because to turn pants into skirt, it's just a matter of removing that inseam crotch area. So let me show you how easy that is by something I have here on the rack. Now, a couple of things I have. This one used to be, it's now a skirt. Everything matches beautifully, all the plaids. It's now a skirt, an A-line skirt, actually. It used to be culottes. So realize the size of your legs is going to determine what kind of a skirt you have. And culottes, of course, meant big, wide legs, therefore wide hem on the skirt. So this is what you can produce from this. From jeans, if they're straight-legged or even if they're kind of narrow legs, you're not going to have that kind of an A-line skirt. It's going to be a little slim skimp of a skirt. Now here's what I have wasted, or what I have eliminated, as I made these culottes into a skirt. Here's the leftover piece, and this would, of course, been the inner legs of it. So it's simply cutting off the crotch area, the inseam, or part of it, and then restitching the front two pieces together and the back two pieces together, and it turns into a skirt. It's that easy. But let me show you from start to finish how easy it is to do. So this might be a good idea on something that you're no longer wearing as pants. How about doing that conversion? Or if you find in your career or whatever that you need skirts, not pants, maybe you have some nice looking pants, some dressier pants that you could convert to skirts if it is something you need. Well, here's a pair of pants that I no longer want as pants. You just reach into them way down to the ankles and grab both of the ankles and pull the legs through together so that you have them inside out. And along with having them inside out, one leg is going to be inside the other. So I need to take a second here to get this all straightened out and in place. And then when I put them down on the table, what I need to do is, I'll get my hands in here to straighten out those legs and get them right together, because I want, of course, the seams to coincide, have everything come out just right. I'll just tuck the pockets in here to get them out of the way. Now, as you saw in the jean skirt I'm wearing, here was the leftover piece. What this was just eliminating, this would have been, yes, the legs. So it was just eliminating something like this. I just wanted to eliminate that much, and then I could stitch the front and back together. So, first of all, think, how long do I want this skirt to be? And if you have very narrow legs, you don't want it to be very long, because you're going to have a hobble skirt. You won't be able, and we're going back in time, a hobble skirt, of course, would have been kind of during the 1910s. They could just barely walk along with little steps because those skirts were so tight at the bottom. So you don't want this very long. You're not going to walk that way. You want a big stride the way you ordinarily do. So if it's going to be very straight, narrow legs, then cut it off kind of short, probably somewhere above your knees. So the easy way to do this, to gauge what kind of a skirt you're going to get out of it really, is think, okay, how long do I really want this, and what could I produce at that point? If I drop this down, the length I actually have on this skirt is 22 inches, I see. So I would just measure down here 22 inches and see what that would produce. I have two legs here, and I see this measures at this point 10 inches, and so times two, because it would go all the way around, so that would be 20 inches per leg that I have, a total of 40 inches. Measure some straight skirt that you have and see if 40 inches is going to do the trick. Now, as I picture a 45-inch piece of fabric, if you could use that as a skirt length and get one skirt out of a 45-inch one, then you have plenty there. If you find, oh, that's going to be a little snug around the bottom, think about a slit. You can always do that. You could also take some of that cut-off leg fabric that you no longer are using for legs, since they're removed, and put some sort of a kick pleat in there if you wanted to. So there are other things you could do. You could even use that to make a godet, maybe. Here we're going into the 30s, and a godet is one of those little flared things. There's a seam that comes down and then the seam is slit, and in that seam you add a godet. So these are all possibilities. These are all things you could do. But I'm just going to say, okay, I want this about 22 inches long. I want to have a hem. This isn't going to be a big deep hem. It's just going to be a little 5/8 inch hem turned up twice and top stitched around the bottom is what I did with these jeans so that it looked the same as the rest of the stitching on the jeans. So anyway, I would put it down here the length I want. I would add to that whatever hem it is, and at that point I'd cut it off. Here I have a marker, and I'm just going to cut it off. I'll use this to make kind of a straight line. And I'm going to give it a little extra, a little more than I actually want, because once it's all opened up, I might need a little extra for evening it, for straightening it out, in case it blips down to a little point in front or back and I want to straighten it. So I'll add a little bit to that, and I'll just make a line across this so that it's kind of perpendicular to the seam line is what I've made my line. And once that's there, they're ready to be cut off. So once you've cut, you can't change your mind. This is it. You're either going to have cutoffs or else you turn it into a skirt. So I'm just cutting through all four of the layers at once here. And that might be, take a little bit of strength if you're doing this in denim. This is a lighter weight cotton. Okay, now what I need to do in order to turn this into a skirt is just remove this inner area here. And take a yardstick if it's long enough. Mine's just a short skirt here, so it doesn't need much. I see that on this fashion ruler, the straight side is 16 inches. That's probably enough. Now what you want to do here is just get a straight line going. Now here's the back seam and here's the front seam with the fly front zipper. I just want to get a straight line going down this seam and then continuing on to wherever it ends up down here at the bottom so that I can remove this wedge area here. So I would just put this right along here, get it all folded in place, and where it starts to curve around the crotch, this is where you want to depart from their stitching line and make your own straight line to go down for that front seam or back seam in this case. And I'm going to go down not quite to the bottom. I can fudge a little bit there because maybe I'm going to put a slit in this to make it just a little bit wider for walking space. Or I might decide after it's all stitched together and I have it on before I hem it, I might even decide to cut it off a little shorter. So that's a decision you can make as long as you've left plenty there to change your mind about. Okay, so I'll just make a little mark here. And this is not going to be my cutting line. This is going to be my stitching line because I need to have a seam, of course. So when I stitch this later, I need to first of all have a seam. So I'll cut it off a little wider. And I'll do the same thing here on the front side. We'll just put it so that it kind of goes with that front seam, the center front, and so that it meets the back here. Although it isn't important that it meets the back because remember, you're going to stitch front to front and back to back, and so it isn't really important. They're going to be completely separate. But I'd go ahead and make a line here. And then when I cut this off, I'll just leave some extra there so that I have a seam allowance so that I can finish it off on the serger the way the rest of it has been finished on the serger. And it might even be a good idea, if you're really saving time, to go ahead and pin this before you cut it, so that you are then ready to just stitch the two back center backs together and the two center fronts together, and you're ahead of the game if you do it this way. So I'll go ahead and put a few pins in here and be all ready to go. And all I'll have to do then, of course, is when I get way down to the bottom, I'll have to rip out some stitches. I don't want to cut anything off down there. I want every bit that I have. So I'll leave those seam allowances intact right now as I cut and just worry about them later. So, okay, here are going to be my stitching lines. Go ahead and cut it off where I don't want it anymore. And I'll do the same thing here on the front of it. So I just have enough there for seams left over. Okay, here's the waist. Here's what I don't want, the same as I had cut off my jeans. That's what's going to be thrown away unless you can find a good use for it. And now I just need to take the ripper to open that up. Then I'm going to go ahead and stitch the center front and the center back together, and I'm going to have a skirt out of this. It's going to be that simple. So this might not be a bad conversion. Years ago when I taught at the university, my seniors would do a lot of this. They had lived in pants all their lives and they suddenly needed career clothes, so they were changing a lot of pants into skirts so that they would go to offices or school, classrooms, whatever. Now when you do some stitching, if you do this in denim, you know it's a little hard to stitch through some layers of denim, so be prepared for it, and here's the preparation you're going to need. You're going to need, for one thing, to put in a strong denim needle. It's going to help you out because you can break needles very easily when you go across these heavy, multi-layered areas. So right here, I'm going to need to do a little, I'll just show you what I would do to stitch this. As you get close to any of these very thick areas, and I have also not only the heavy needle, what I would also use on the denim especially is, this is gold, but I would probably use a beige. I would find a color of buttonhole twist of heavy thread that would simulate what's already there, that would kind of match, and you can find this easily. Okay, once I get near this heavy spot, now where you break needles typically and where you have a problem moving on is when you graduate up to these multi-thicknesses of fabric. So right here I would leave the needle in so I could raise the presser foot and use, now this is a lift, this is really a button lift that I have here that you'd put under a button to stitch it on by machine so it elevates it and produces a shank, but also use something of this sort as a wedge just so that you can keep the foot level. So here's keeping the foot level. I'd put that wedge under. You can also buy various things in your local notions departments and the fabric shops that lift that area. And you see this way the foot is kept flat and you aren't going to have any problems. When I get this far, I'm going to again lift the foot, put this in front of it so that I have this little platform to stitch on, and again, it won't be any problem. It's a terrible problem if you just try to stitch up and down again without using any sort of a wedge this way, because you're going to break needles, as I said. You're going to have a really tough time of it. Another little project I'd like to show you down here on the table is this bag. And this might be a bag to use just as a purse, just as a handbag. This is another pair of jeans, obviously. I didn't even change them terribly much. It was from about a decade or more ago. They look very new. They aren't. They're old. But this is when my hips were a little narrower than they are now. I have no use anymore for these jeans, no way to wear them. So these are the type to turn into a handbag if you can't ever put them on again. And you can see they're pretty much intact. I have outside pockets, both front and back. What I've cut off these is just the legs. And this is about all the waist I have left from one pair of jeans. One leg is what I have remaining. So let me tell you about this. I'm not going to have time to demonstrate it completely, but I'll tell you about this as much as I can. Now I'll just take another old pair of jeans here to cut up. They've already been cut up somewhat. But you can see what I did with this bag. It's just barely below the zipper that I went ahead and cut them off. So decide how deep do you want this bag. You don't want it terribly deep or you'll be reaching forever, unless you're going to use it as a beach bag, a book bag, something like that. Then you might want it deeper. But if you're actually using it as a purse, decide where. I think I want mine cut off about here, just barely below the zipper is where I cut those off. So I just went ahead and cut wherever that was. Now you might figure also how deep is the pocket if you don't want to cut off the pocket, and mine is below the pocket so I can still find it useful. So I've just cut this whole thing off, and then I didn't want it all this wide, so you can see what I did here. This is one of the leg that I've already cut up, and what I wanted is all this neat stitching because it looks pretty there. Why do it yourself as long as you can just borrow from what was there before? So I cut a strip right down this leg that was approximately 3 inches wide because I've used a seam on both sides. I cut that strip off the whole length of the leg and that's sewn all the way around the bottom of the bag. What I did first of it after I had that whole strip cut off is simply make it into a ring. And once I had stitched it into a ring, here's the stitching line where I stitched it. After I made it into a ring, that determined the bottom size of the bag, actually, by the size of the rim. And so as I was pinning it on, I just made pleats in the legs of these jeans. That would be like this. I just made pleats as I went along so that it would fit that rim that I already had. I then also took the size of that rim and cut this oval for the bottom of the bag. And now that oval was just as long as it needed to be and as wide. I cut it a little bit longer than I thought I really needed it because I didn't want to run short. And as I stitched, I started in the middle and stitched toward the ends and did the same thing from the back side, stitched toward the ends, so I could then just trim off what I didn't need for the oval that was too much there on the bottom. For the top, I took some more of the leg and just did like this. This leg actually is the one I have for the flap that comes over the top here. For this flap, I just cut the whole leg without cutting any seams. That's a fold there, and there's a fold where it's attached underneath here too. I simply cut a big chunk like this shape, out of the leg, and it already, as you see, has this seam on it because I wanted to use as much of the seams as possible. They're pretty. And so it seemed like a good idea to just leave that alone. And then I just tucked in the edges, the raw edges where I had cut. I tucked it in, pressed it in place before I did all this top stitching. This is just for ballast, just because you can close it and it stays in place. I have a piece of driftwood here and some shells because they're kind of heavy and they hold it down nicely. What I have put inside is just a print lining that goes nicely with denim. It's also cotton, washable, so it works well. Now, of course, I'm not going to be able to wash this with the driftwood on it. I'd have to take it off if I planned to wash it. But why, come to think of it? It's been sitting in the ocean for eons, so maybe I wouldn't have to take it off. But anyway, this lining is very simple to make also. You don't have to worry about shaping it exactly to the jeans. All you need to have is a rectangle of fabric, which I have here on a smaller size, but my rectangle of fabric just needs to be the very same width as this, as it's folded in half, and it needs to be approximately that deep. So that's easy. You're not going to have to do anything complicated. And what I would do then with this rectangle of fabric is just fold it over and stitch two sides, which I might as well go ahead and do here. I would just stitch this across the bottom and also across the one side, and then we would press over the top. I'll just finger press it to show you how. Once you get to the corner here, stop with the needle in and turn the corner and stitch up the side. And then on the ironing board, I would just press this over, but I'm going to show you just with my fingers. Okay, I'll just press over the top because this is going to be top stitched in place inside the bag. So we do all this and get it all pressed over. And then this isn't squared off the way the purse is, and we want it to have some depth. So the easy way to give it some depth is just refold the corners the opposite direction. I'd fold them so the seam was right along the bottom, and so that the side fold here is along the top, and I would just stitch across there however much depth I want, probably just about an inch or so from the corner. I'd stitch across there, and then we have a squared off bag instead of one that comes down to pointed corners. So you do this on both corners, and you can see then it would be all squared off and have some dimension to it. Then what you do with this is just tuck it inside your bag and top stitch around the edges. Now notice before I top stitched around the edges, you can kind of see the hard edge of the flap sticking through here, or I can feel it at least. Maybe you can see the impression. So I would just cover all this with the lining, top stitch around the edge here before I top stitch some more of the leg I cut off to make this shoulder strap, and we've got a really neat bag that all ages would love to make or carry in just a really short time. I have a couple of other things here on the rack I'd like to briefly show you. One of these is this jacket. Now, I showed this to you a few series ago as a recyclable by adding some gold braid. There were a lot of stars and stripes and military looks this past year or two. So that's one way. Here's another way to recycle it. It's not wearable right now because it's half and half, but how about just putting a little lace on a suit, on the cuffs and on the lapel, and make it something completely new. I acquired recently some more lace that I really like. It's wool lace, and I thought how perfect that would be on this sweater. I haven't been wearing this as a turtleneck sweater. It's kind of hot and itchy around the neck. So what I'm going to do instead is cut it down. I'm going to sew the lace on first, and then I'll just trim away what I don't want of the sweater and make it a V-neck. I'll probably trail some of this lace down the sleeve and then cut out the sweater behind it afterwards. So just all sorts of ideas you can get if you look through and if you do some sorting out and see what happens. Now, one of the nice things I think about working with lace is the fact that it's not going to fray, it's not going to ravel, so you can cut around the motifs very nicely. Here's some more of that lace that I had, and you can see on this side where I've already cut around the motif. Where it is not cut around, it isn't too impressive at all. It doesn't show up very nicely. I'll put it down on the dark so that it does. But you can see that looks terrible. But if I would very carefully cut around the design, I have something very nice going for me here. So this is the way you would work with it in order to do that. Just take your little scissors and cut very carefully. So I've already done that on this strap that I have here. Or this strip that I have here. Now, what's an easy way to work with this is either it may be on the hanger or possibly put it on a dress form so that you can get it all pinned in place. While we're in the clean out, get rid of mood, consider all those fabric scraps in your stash. In just the right colors, they could be very useful. Next time, we're going to do a really fun project producing something pretty from old scraps, the scrap basket. Come join me then.